immediately follow it. Then he sees James and John, sons of Zebedee, and he calls to them too, and they leave their father and follow. I've often wondered how Zebedee might have described the whole scenario if his kids just jump up and run off, leaving him to clean up the net. Something tells me that the gospel according to Zebedee might have had a few more words to describe this particular event. But regardless, Jesus now has four disciples that we know of, and he sets off on a healing tour throughout Galilee. His fame spreads. Word gets around that this man has the power to heal, and great crowds follow him from Galilee, the Decapolis, Jerusalem, Judea, and from beyond the Jordan. If you recall, we heard this passage read aloud just last week. Now that all of these crowds are following Jesus, as soon as he sees them, he hurries up a mountain. Some might say that that is simply a wise man knowing when to retreat, backing away slowly, realizing he's outnumbered here. But scholars are quick to point out that his going up that mountain before beginning his sermon is a distinct and intentional parallel to Moses going up Mount Sinai to speak with God. But instead of bringing the word of God's law, Jesus brings a word of how God sees the world. It can be tempting for us to read or hear the Beatitudes, this list of blessed be's, as merely a to-do list to sort of check off as we go about our days. And that assumption may be somewhat correct, only in part. Because when we start looking at this so-called to-do list, these are not all things that seem advisable for us to aim for. To be meek here is not just to be shy, but downtrodden or easily imposed upon. To be hungry for righteousness, as though something has caused us to become deeply wanting after experiencing injustice after injustice in this world. To be poor in spirit, to be in mourning. Surely these are not things that most of us go out seeking. Surely these are not listed as the top priorities on our daily planners or as cell phone alerts. Siri, set a reminder for 6 p.m. to be meek and poor in spirit. But the Beatitudes in Matthew can actually be divided up into two sections. The first four areas all begin with the same letter in the Greek, which can be a signal of intentional grouping. Poor, mourn, meek, and hunger, all in the same letter. Poor, potochoi, mourn, penthuntes, meek, prais, and hunger, henontes. These four Beatitudes that seem like a little strange aspirations may not be aspirations at all. What if Jesus isn't charging those within earshot to do or be these things? Is highlighting for all who hear that these people, not the powerful, not the fed and content, these are the ones who are especially honored by God. Jesus is saying to the crowd, in those moments when you find yourself feeling a deep poverty of spirit, you are still part of God's kingdom. In fact, heaven is yours. While you grieve, God is with you. Comfort will one day come, even if you can't yet see the light. Those who are pushed down and pushed around in this world, those who are outcasts, God's love for you is so great that God would give you the whole world. And in that everlasting life to come, you will find the peace you long for. You who have been pushed to the margins so many times that all you can hunger for anymore is righteousness, you would exchange your daily bread in an instant for God's justice to be done here and now. You will be satisfied one day. Jesus is communicating blessing here, not just setting up the conditions under which one can receive blessing. He's saying that those who fall into these categories have a special place in God's kingdom. They are honored the way that Jesus himself sees the world, both the world that is and the world that is to come. This is an invitation for all who hear the Sermon on the Mount to reorient the way in which they changes us, how he just can't snap our fingers and move beyond. Instead of giving a new set of laws from on top of this mountain, Jesus provides a divine opportunity for hearers to look around and see the world in a new way, with eyes intent upon seeing others as God sees them. How would our individual actions change, I wonder, if we saw the marginalized and the mourning in this world and immediately thought, heirs of the kingdom of heaven, inheritors of the earth, beloved of God. Maybe, just maybe, if we could figure out how to see the world that way, we'd have a little more gumption responding to the second half of the Beatitudes, when Jesus calls us to be merciful and pure in heart and peacemakers, those who seek the righteousness. Maybe, just maybe, those Beatitudes can be experienced by us as Jesus communicating God's own blessing when we are the ones who need it most. As Professor Lance Pate puts it, the list we find here is the indicative mood, not the imperative. All you who love grammar, rejoice. It is description. It is description, not prescription. What Jesus is saying is that God looks upon such people with favor. God's eye is on them. They will be happy in the end. This, says Jesus, is the way things are. But if we are honest, we must admit that the world Jesus asserts as fact is not the world that we have made for ourselves. Until that day, the Beatitudes stand against the current order. Jesus cannot very well insist that we be poor in spirit, but he can show us how to look upon such people with new eyes and so gain entrance into a new world. The kingdom Jesus proclaimed in the body is precisely a new way of seeing, a new way of naming, and so a new way of being. We learn to recognize such people as blessed. We give our hearts to that new world, even as we participate in its realization. To reorient, to change our focus, to change our direction. It is to find our position again in relation to our surroundings. It is to relocate our very selves while standing right where we've been all along. Simply by looking around at the world and trying to see it as Jesus describes. Reorienting can feel a bit disorienting sometimes, too. I'm exactly where I was yesterday, but suddenly I can see the humanity of the person who just yesterday I was ready and willing to ignore. So perhaps in light of these Beatitudes, we can spend some time asking ourselves, praying for God's guidance in our discerning. Who am I missing here as I go about my daily routine? Who do my eyes need to be opened to see? Who would Jesus himself call out as honored or blessed in this world that I inhabit? Remembering that those he called out as especially blessed while sitting on that mountain are not the same ones that this world tends to admire. Reorientation is about seeing the world anew so that we can respond differently than we are accustomed to. Viewing and doing, as a friend put it this week. When we are the ones in those first four categories of the Beatitudes, recognize that Jesus is blessing us exactly as we are, not just as we one day will become. And when we're not the ones in those first four Beatitudes, may our way of seeing shift so that we can help those who feel hopeless know that the kingdom of God is theirs too. Today we fill up blessing bags. Saw some of you filling them over there before the service. The catch is, they're still sitting there. You are to take those with you. Take them with you. Inside of them, if you didn't get to package one, chapsticks and hand warmers and foot warmers. nuts, so you might want to make sure you ask people first if they have a nut allergy when you hand these out. But the idea is simple. Take these with you and give them to someone who needs them. And I want you to know that Community Service and Action Committee chose this date without realizing that our lectionary text involved the blessed bees. I think it's a Holy Spirit moment, because as we look at these bags, I don't see them just as passing along a physical blessing from someone who has to someone who has not. See these bags as a way of acknowledging those who Jesus himself calls blessed, honored ones in God's kingdom, those who will inherit the earth. I see our giving these bags out in our daily routines as a way of allowing God to open our eyes to our fellow human beings who we might be inclined to walk right on by any other day. I see these bags as a way of allowing us to live out a reorientation of seeing each other in the world. So when we take these with us, we are leaving these church doors actively on the lookout for those who are so often marginalized. When you meet someone who could use one of these bags on your commute or as you're driving to the store or wherever it is that you keep them, go out on a limb when you're ready and tell them your name. Give them a smile, eyes wide open, and be ready to hear the name and perhaps even part of the story of your sister or brother in response. I'm amazed at how many people shuffle right on by those who are visibly homeless, or at least seem to have fallen on hard times without so much as eye contact. I've done it myself. In a hurry or don't have anything to give, feel a little awkward about it, head down, just keep moving. These bags offer each of us the chance for an encounter in which we take the time to see each other. We may be surprised by what happens. Yesterday, I was near the Giant here in McLean, and someone in the parking lot needed a meal. I thought to myself, I really wish I'd taken a blessing bag with me in the car after I set that table up. But I hadn't had the foresight at that point to take one with me. So I went into the store and came out with a little food and some water, and I handed the bag over to the man and asked for his name. Now, I need to tell you that I've handed out bags like this since I was a teenager in Dallas, when someone at the church first showed me how to do this. So I did not expect at all that this particular exchange would be much different than all of the other times this has occurred throughout the course of my life. We exchanged a very brief conversation, and then he looked me in the eye and tentatively put out his hand as though he wasn't so sure if I would shake it. When I did, held my hand, and he looked at me while he said in the most gentle, sincere tone, "Bless you, beautiful sister." The way he offered that blessing to me, I cannot adequately describe. When a preacher is at a loss for words, you know something to happen. Already right there with the people we hand them to. reorientation. It's about learning to see God's world differently, so that instead of jumping to judgment or dismissal, we can respond with mercy and peacemaking and seeking righteousness even when we're tired. Reorientation is about seeing and responding. It's about viewing and doing. Reorientation is about three teenagers who spent a Saturday working at a shared food drive with Nancy Stansberry earlier this year. And at the end of their shift, they reached into their own pockets and gave $10 of their own money to help feed people after seeing so many people all day give and give and give. Viewing, doing. Reorientation is about people across the country who are tying scarves and hats and gloves to trees and signposts in areas where those without homes frequent, with little notes on them that say things like, "I'm not lost. Take me if you need me and stay warm." This is happening just around the corner in Alexandria. Reorientation is sometimes about the ability to see a tree limb as an opportunity to share kindness and warmth, and then others see that and go home instead of knitting. Viewing and doing. Jesus is sitting on a mountain today, not handing us a set of new laws, but inviting us into a divine way of seeing the world. Reorientation is not about charity. It's about justice. It's about justice and mercy and recognizing and highlighting God's blessing and God's love. So as we go into the world today, tomorrow, and the next day, can we become open to God changing the way that we look at the world, receiving God's grace and love when we need it most, and sharing the very same when our work